Good afternoon to everybody. Myself, Dr. Vijay Raut, Assistant Professor, Department of Zoology, Thai Golwalkar Mahavidyalay, Ramtek, Nagpur, Maharashtra. I am very much thankful to Dr. Pitambar Humne sir, the founder of Botany for You and Associate Professor and Head, the Department of Botany, Dharampet MP Dev Memorial Science College, Nagpur, for giving me an opportunity on online platform to deliver a guest lecture on the topic Entrepreneurship Development through the Life Cycle, Life Sciences, a Model Approach of the Sericulture. So once again, thank you Humne sir and your team. So today's my topic is Entrepreneurship Development through the Life Cycle. So this is my first slide. Now, what is sericulture? Sericulture is an agro-based industry, the end product of which is a silk. The domesticated silkworm species, that is Bombyx mori, Latin, evolved almost 4,600 years ago from the wild species Bombyx mandarina mori, which is a native of China and Palearctic region. The eggs of silkworm Bombyx mori were first introduced from China into the Japan, followed by the Korea in the first century, and subsequently into the Middle Eastern and European countries, and finally into the neighboring countries around China in the 6th century. If you see the historical background of silkworm, which got the entry into the India, is still a mystery, and the historical evidence shows that the silk was flourished and practiced between India and Rome, Greece, during the Kanishka period, which is dated 56 BC. Now this is the silk route from where the silk migrate from China to the other parts of the world. Now basically there are the four different kinds of silkworm which we have found. The first variety of silkworm is called as mulberry silk, and it is called as mulberry silkworm, and the main host plant is mulberry Morus alba and Morus indica. The mulberry silk is very important and is the second largest country. India is the second largest country in the world after China, which produces mulberry silk. All the silk produced in China is of bivoltine nature. Let me confirm you, the bivoltine means in a year there was a two crop, it is called as bivoltine. Multivoltine means in a year when we take more than 3 to 4 crops, it is called as multivoltine. So all the silk produced in China is of bivoltine, and in our country more than 95% of the silk is of multivoltine silk. Our weaver specifically prefer this multivoltine silk for making our traditional dresses material because of its luster, smoothness, color absorption, get-up, drapping quality, etc., which lacks in imported Chinese bivoltine silk. So the mulberry silk is plays very important role, and here about 80% of the mulberry silk we produce. Now the next silk is tassel silk. Tassel silk is the silkworm, the scientific name is called as Anthea mylita, and the main host plant is Arjun, that is Terminalia arjuna, and Azan, Terminalia tomentosa. It is also called as Kosa silk. In Sanskrit, it is also called as Kosa silk. Tassel silk is valued for its rich luster, texture, and natural deep gold color, and varieties are produced in many countries like China, India, Japan, and Sri Lanka. Whereas India is the second largest producer of tassel silk and exclusively producer of Indian tassel, that is also called as tropical tassel. Much of it is produced in Bhagalpur, but it is called as Bhagalpur silk, which is present in the Bihar and Malda districts of West Bengal. Chhattisgarh and Madhya Pradesh also produces tassel silk, and in recently Jharkhand has emerged as the biggest producer of Tassar silk, and which is very much famous for its luster and quality. The Tassar silk, also called as oak Tassar silkworm, and the silkworm name is Anthria perini aprioli, because the main host plant is oak, hence it is called as oak Tassar silkworm. The third one is Airy. It is also called as ND or Airandi. Airy silkworm, and the scientific name is Phyllosemia ricini, and the main host plant is Castor, that is Ricinus communis, Heteropanax fragrans. Airy silkworm, that is Semia ricini, found in northeast part of the India. As the Airy is derived from the Assamese word Ira, which means castor, as it feed on the castor plant. It is also known as Endi or Erandi in India. The woolly white silk, this is a specific silk which is called as woolly white silk, is often referred to as the fabric of peace, because when it is a process, it is processed without killing the silkworm. This is the main point of Airy, that Airy silk was produced without killing the silkworm, whereas in other silkworm, we have to kill the silkworm to obtain the fiber. Hence, it is also called as Ahimsa silk. The Airy silkworm is the only completely domesticated silkworm other than the Bombyx mori. Now, the next one is Muga silk. Muga silkworm, the scientific name for the Muga silkworm is Antheria assamensis. As the name suggests, it only confined to the Assam part of the India. And the main host plant is Soam, that is Maculus bombacina, Saulu litsia polyantha. Muga silk is a variety of wild silk after Tassar silk, and this Muga silk is geographically tagged to the state of Assam in India. It is the only state which produces Muga silk, and this silk is known for its extreme durability and has a natural yellowish golden tint with a shimmering glossy texture. The silks can be hand washed with its luster increasing after every wash. So hence this Muga silk is very economically viable, and it have a geographically tag. So this is all about the four types of silk. Now, for the having a silk, we need a plantation, and for the plantation we need a soil. So we need a black soil. Apart from that, we also use a loamy and clay soil, a red soil specifically in the southern part of the country, and a climatic condition that is 750 to 1000 millimeter rain was required with the average humidity, and the temperature must reach near about 25 to 35 degree Celsius. So this kind of temperature and soil is required for the plantation of the food or host plant. Now, the method of plantation. We require the row system, that is 3.3 feet or 3.2 feet or 2.2 feet, which produces 4 to 4400 plants per acre if we go for this row system. We also have the Chinese method or Aurangabad system, which include 1 into 2 into 6 feet or 1 into 2 into 5 feet. If we go for this method, then for the per acre, we should plant 10,000 to 10,800 plants. Apart from that, we can also have the intercultivation will be done after 1 to 1.5 months of the plantation, then 2 to 3 months to remove the weeds and grasses to get more aeration and light for the growth. So this is the plantation method. Normal condition, we use 5 into 3 into 2 type of row system. If you see the plantation, we have a gap of 5 foot between the two rows, and in the subsequent rows we have 3 feet gap. and in between the two plants there must be a 2 feet gap, hence it is also called as 5-3-2, 5-3-2, ऐसा भी उसको बोला करते हैं. So this is the plantation and this is the variety of mulberry. Nowadays we use V1 or in some part G1 or MP Kanwa 2 also use. Now these mulberry plantation, the mulberry have various kinds of disease if we could not manage it properly. And if the mulberry have a disease, then we could not get the economic condition which we are using for the silkworm. So if the disease take place in the mulberry plantation, the food or the silkworm feed, mulberry leaves get low production and low protein level. As a result of that, we could not get the proper yield which was we expected. So there are number of types of diseases. The first one is leaf spot disease, then powdery mildew, red rust disease, root knot disease, hopper burn, tukra disease, and all these diseases can be cured. That is 0.2% Kavach Perishield Chlorothalonil 75%. We can use it after 8 days. Now the next and very important part of the silkworm is life cycle of the silkworm. Specifically, we are deal with the Bombyx mori. So Bombyx mori, we get the eggs from the NSSO. And once we get the eggs, after hatching the eggs, immediately we have to feed them, and we will feed by the chalky rearing. Total we have the 5 instar to complete the life cycle. The first instar, which have 3 to 4 days feeding days, after that it undergo the molting process, and after molting process again they feed for 2.5 or 3 days, again they undergo the second mold, and once they pass the second mold, again they feed near about 3 to 4 day, and after completion of 3 to 4 day of feeding, they undergo third molt, which took place for the 5 days. 4 days they feed, and they undergo final molt. And once the larva enters into the 5th instar, it took 6 to 8 days to complete the 5th instar. And in the late 5th instar, the larva, which was white in color, now turn yellowish in color because of silk filament, and this condition is called as ripe silkworm. And this ripe silkworm, when we kept in the mount edges, they start spinning the cocoon, and in 1 or 2 days they produces the whole cocoon. And if we cut the whole cocoon, we will find the pupa present in that. And if we remain the cocoon for about 10 to 12 days, the pupa convert into adult moth, and adult moth by creating a hole in the pupa, in the cocoon, they emerge out, and the cocoon was wasted. The emerged moth, they are non-feeding stage, and once they emerge, they search for the partner and they start mating immediately, and after mating, the male moth die and the female moth start egg laying, and once they lay the egg, they again undergo the hatching process. So this is all about life cycle of silkworm, and this all silkworm is completed near about 28 or 26 days. So within a month we will have the cocoon in our hand. So this is the DFL, that is, and the loose eggs are there. This is the Biovoltaic hybrid loose eggs we got from the Silkworm Seed Production Center, Mysore. And this is the DFL, that is disease free egg layings. This is laid by a single female. So this is the loose eggs. After 10 to 12 days, the new instar hatches out. A black small part is called as first instar. So this is the proper spacing of the first instar, very minute tiny caterpillars, eager to feed the mulberry leaves. So this is the chalky rearing procedure. Out of 5 instar, the first, second and third instar need chalky rearing. So chalky rearing means we have to provide more, still about 70 to 80% humidity, and for that we have foam covered and we will cover all the trays so that the moisture be maintained. So they need little bit temperature plus high amount of humidity, and because of this, they progress very fastly and they eat more and more leaves of the mulberry and they grow. So this is chalky rearing. Chalky rearing is a very important part of the silkworm rearing. If we do not have the proper chalky rearing, then there was a chances of disease appearance. So this is the fresh first instar larva after feeding the leaves. Again, this is a close view of the first instar larva. The whitish is the larva. They have fed all the green leaves. This is the again magnified views. This is the molting process. This first instar now undergoing molting process. Look at the skin. The skin is quite shiny and the head is quite larger and they are around the straight. They have the blackish spot. So these are the molting stage. So this is the completed molting stage. We have kept on the dusting process. So we have to dust the calcium powder, the name of Vegeta, locally available, and this prevent the silkworm against various diseases. So dusting plays a very important role in the silkworm rearing. This is the second instar larva. For the second instar larva, we have to chop a larger mulberry leaf. This is the third instar larva, quite large in the size. This is the fourth instar larva. This is the fifth instar larva. And once the fifth instar larva have completed 6 or 7 days, they start ripening, and once they start ripening, they have to shift to the chandrika, which is made from the bamboo, or nowadays we use the plastic chandrika. And once we put up the silkworm into the chandrika, they start spinning and form the cocoons. So this is a cocoon, and this, if we cut the cocoon, we will found this a tiny brownish color pupa. One is a male and another is a female. And if we remain this cocoon for near about 10 days, this pupa convert into adult moth inside the cocoon, and this moth comes out from the cocoon. And as soon as they comes out, the male and female moth start mating, and once they completed mating, the male moth died and the female moth, as shown in the figure, start laying the egg. Very tiny egg was there. Now this is the farmer with the fifth instar platform rearing, and in the platform rearing they just put up the shoots of mulberry plants, and then they kept all the 15 star larva and they start feeding voraciously. This technique will reduce the labor cost. And then they completed the cocoon formation in the plastic made chandrika on the platform itself. And this is the newly built up rearing house. This is the rearing house, 3-tier rearing house. We will found the ventilations are there, and this ventilation is very important for the rearing of the silkworm. This is the tribal woman who have just built up this rearing house for the mulberry, for the silkworm rearing. And this is the production of cocoon, a white cocoon. This is the bivoltine cocoon, double hybrid bivoltine cocoon. Now the diseases of the silkworm. Silkworm have near about 4 main diseases, and it is very important diseases. Every silkworm rearer or farmer should know these diseases, otherwise all these cycles get vanish after completion of 15 days. If the disease comes, the whole hard work and the lot of economy get wasted in the 1 month. So the first one is Gracilis disease, which is due to the viral part. The picture shown as A, it is normal, where the B is an infected one. If you see, the node like structure was there in the silkworm, and this is only due to the viral infection. And once the infection was take place in the rearing house, it will spread to the other silkworm also. Second one is Flacheri. It is caused by the bacteria. After the infection, the silkworm get blackish in color and they are non-feeding, and they can have the ability to spread this disease to the normal one. Third disease, that is muscarding. It is caused due to the fungus, and here the whole silkworm, when infected with the fungal disease, they look like a white chalk. Hence sometimes it is also called as chalky disease. And the last one is Pebrin. It is caused by the protozoa, and in this kind of protozoan disease, a small black spot appear on the surface of the silkworm. Hence it is also called as paper disease. And all these four disease, when appear during the silkworm rearing, it have the capacity to spread this disease to other silkworm also. So as soon as we can see this disease, immediately we have to vanish it off, burn it off, or ground it off. Otherwise this will create a nuisance during the silkworm cycle, and you will not complete the life cycle of the silkworm, and you will get a loss for that month. So how can we control or manage the diseases? The first method is, we can use the 2% bleaching powder in 0.3% slake lime solution. And to prepare this solution, we require 100 liter of solution. Then we have to add a little water to 2 kg bleaching powder and 300 gram slake lime powder, and make a paste, and add this paste to the rest of the water and stir thoroughly. Keep for 10 minutes and use the supernatant. And once we use this, please close the rearing house and its appliances, and then in the other day we have to clean the rearing house and appliances. Then we can start the next rearing cycle of the mulberry silkworm. Otherwise, the infected part of the disease or remnant will again cause or get disturbed in the next cycle. Now, after formation of the cocoon, the most important part is extraction of silk fiber from the cocoon. On an average, if quality silkworm was produced from a single quality silkworm, we have to unearth the 800 to 900 meter of silk fiber. It will be asset for the rearers that a A grade cocoon has the highest range, highest cost also. So the cocoon stifling, the first process in the cocoon reeling, we have to stifle the cocoons. Now, what is stifling? The process of killing the pupa and drying of cocoons is known as stifling of the cocoons. Cocoon stifling includes the following methods, that is sun drying, steam stifling, hot air conditioning. Most of the farmers which do not have this facility of steam stifling, hot air conditioning, they can use sun drying method. They just take their whole cocoon and spread on the ground or their wooden plates and on the sun, in the below the sun, and they keep for near about 6 to 7 hours. After keeping the 6 to 7 hours, due to sun heat, all the pupa or all the cocoon get dry and pupa get killed. Now the killing the pupa in the cocoon by exposing the fresh cocoon, steam stifling includes the basket steaming, barrel steaming, chamber steaming, etc. So the basket steaming and barrel steaming were used by the poor farmers, whereas the chamber steaming is a new innovation, but it requires electricity and it's quite worthful, but it requires money also. So most of the farmers who have 1 acre or 2 acre land, they don't use this chamber steaming. Either they use a sun drying or basket or barrel steaming. Now the hot air dryer. In the advanced country, the stifling of the cocoon by steam has been largely replaced by hot air, which also dries the stifled cocoon. This method of stifling and drying the cocoons is known as hot air conditioning. This is the diagram of hot air conditioning. And hot air conditioning is carried out in a specially designed chamber with the twin objective of killing the pupa and drying them either fully or partially. Okay, but why we have to dry the cocoon? If we cannot dry the cocoon or we cannot kill the pupa will convert into adult and all the cocoons get useless for the farmer. We cannot reel the silk fiber from the such damaged cocoons. Now after drying the cocoon fully or partially, that cocoon has to be stored in a secured place. That place should be secured from the squirrel, mouse and any other vertebrates. In fact, the ants also. Now before reeling, we have to cocoon sorting and deflossing is a very important process. So we have to collect the quality cocoons. The cocoon should not be doubled. It should not have any particular stain. It should not be cut or damaged by any other things or appliances. Then after selecting the cocoons, we have to defloss them. Some floss was naturally present on the cocoon, so that floss should be removed before the boiling. Otherwise, that floss will hamper the boiling process of the cocoon. So this is the cocoon boiling process. This cocoon boiling process, we can use earthen pots or metal utensils to boil the cocoons. And once the cocoon get boiled, the content, that is fibrin and sericin, which is present in the cocoon, get dissolved and separated. And as a result of that, the silk fiber get loosened and it is very easy to reel the silk fiber. So again, this is the boiling and this is the remnant of the floss present on the surface of the cocoons. And after boiling the cocoon, that cocoon was undergo in a particular type of machine called as multi-end machine. And this multi-end machine reel the cocoon and create the silk fibers. This is automatically reeled machines. So these are the tribal women. They all are trained and they are all using this machine to create the silk fiber or to generate the silk fiber from the boiled cocoon. So once we reel the cocoon, that reel cocoon have a lot of moisture, and due to presence of lot of moisture, the silk quality may be decreased. Hence, to avoid that, the reeled cocoon again get reeled, and that process is called as re-reeling of the silk. And this was done by a new large machines which have a large patta on that with a more diameter. And once it complete this silk gatha, it is called as gatha, was made, it was woven, and it get dried in the presence of sun, and then it get twisted and this twisted fiber is sent to the market for weaving the cloth and various sarees and kurta and dupatta, etc., etc. So this is all about the mulberry to silk fiber. Now this is the one of the largest market, cocoon market in the Asia, which is situated at Ramanagaram near the Bangalore. So whatever the farmers who produced the cocoon, they took out their cocoon here and they sold out here, and they will get enough amount of money on a daily basis. This is the silkworm rearer, a lady who is trained lady who is doing silkworm rearing in Ramtek place where my college is situated. And this is a platform rearing, a college visited or a college visited, and that whole system was monitored and governed by this lady. Her name is Meena Dhote. And this is the again entrepreneurship development, a team, and a really a good example about the silkworm. Our college visited to the Satpura Woman Silk Producer Company situated at Padhal, which is near to the Baitul, Madhya Pradesh. And this man with a cap, and his name is Mr. Dinesh Mende, he started an NGO, Satpura Woman Silk Producer Company. And before starting this company, the situation of this tribal women, all are tribal women, illiterate tribal women, their condition was very much harsh. Even they do not have the enough meal to feed their daughters and sons. So he has initiated this silkworm rearing in that part of the Padhal, and he trained these tribal women. Initially that was a very much difficult. The tribal women could not believe about this silkworm reeling and silkworm farming, but slowly he make a belief in the tribal women, and some women started this silkworm rearing, and slowly the figure increases, and after 4 to 5 years nowadays 1300 tribal women are attached to this Satpura Woman Producer Company. This is the big challenge and big change, transformation. And it was noticed that these women who do not have enough money, enough food to feed their daughters and sons and their livelihood, now they have four wheelers in their house. Now they are very much settled economically, physically and mentally also. So this, I think this was a great story and a very good transformation from this Mr. Dinesh Mende, who have courage to develop, who have brightened their future, and they change them drastically. So Satpura Woman Silk Producer Company is still working, and they have recently started silk reeling in the tribal part. And all the silk reeling units has been governed, maintained and run by only females. No men are doing this silkworm rearing. Men are doing their own different business, but only females are doing this silkworm rearing, and they are earning a lot of more money than we have expected. So we have visited, and we also have the MOU with the Satpura Woman Silk Producer Company, and we go there for any technical advice whenever they required. So silk fiber and their applications. So this silk fiber is useful in the dietary industry, pharmaceutical industry. It also used in the biomedical industry, cosmetic industry, automobile industry, house building and fish food. So each and every part of the silkworm is utilized. Nothing is waste. Even the fecal matter of the silkworm larva can be converted into a proper green manure. The dead pupa, the waste pupa, is also used for the fish food. The broken silk, that is called as ghicha, is also used for the various kinds of, for specifically the tire industries. So each and every part of the silk is utilized, and hence silkworm have the capacity to change from 0 to 100. So these are the cluster, specifically in the northeastern part of the India, where the Muga silkworm and Eri silkworm transform and got the proper employment to the rural and the underprivileged peoples or families. These are the beneficiaries, and this is the group, especially from the South India. They have developed the reeling clusters, and all the work from the plantation of mulberry, maintenance of mulberry, rearing of silkworm, specifically the chowky rearing, then fourth instar, fifth instar, cocoon production, silkworm reeling, all this part was controlled and done by the female only. So this is the one group of the female. And we also have the silkworm sarees. In the international market, we have a lot of demand silk sarees. This is the stole and dupattas from the silk. We can also made a emerald jersey dresses from the silk, and we can have the capacity to import these dresses to all parts of the world. This is the mulberry silk top, a very lustrous and very smoothie. A muslin silk scarf. Most of the fashion shows models use this silk scarf. A clutches, and the purses was made from the silk, and the ghicha, the waist part of the silk. It was really famous. And in the male part, we also have the kurtas and pajamas and dupattas, which was looking very elegant. We also have the silk ties with a different color and pattern. The tassar material, which is very much goldenish color, we can use to have the pillow covers and curtains. Nowadays, the silk mask was prepared and sold online, and huge demand for the silk mask because of its luster and smoothiness. The tablecloth from the silkworm cloth and zardozi silk cushion was there. And now the economics of the silkworm. Now, on one hand, we are saying that there was not a job for the youth, specifically the young people who have completed their graduation or post-graduation. But if you see the global scenario of silk production, it was found that out of total countries, the China took the first or rank first for the silkworm production. This is the recent data. There are about 1,20,000 metric ton silk was produced in near about all the years from the China. If you take the example of India, India was far below when we compare with the China. We have only 31,000 metric tons of the silk, and rest of the country, they are very meager. Only two top nations are there. The first one China and the second one is India. But the gap was very big. So we have the ample capacity of silk production, and we also have the ample capacity to generate the employment and to export the silk, because there was a huge demand of this Indian silk in the foreign countries. So the data was here. We have the ample amount of opportunity. So this is the export. what we have export? We have only export in 1920 that 1,498 crores. So, but in 1819, we almost crosses 2000. But 1920, we have slightly reduction in the export. But in spite of that, the employment generation in the country is raised due to silkworm rearing to 9.52 million person in 1920 as compared to the 9.17 million person in 1890. That indicate there was an increase in the employment ratio of 3.8% in 1 year. This is the export quality. The raw silk import. When we import the raw silk, we use or we import it from the China, because most of the silkworm rearer in India, they use multi-voltain silk. Nowadays, they also started the bi-voltain, but still the bi-voltain silk we have to import from the China. Is about 1000 metric ton of silk was imported in all the 4 years. It means there was a huge demand of the silk, and because of lack of silk in India, we have to import the silk from the China. So we can generate the employment, and this is the woman who used to weave the cloth from the silkworm in the traditional way. As compared to machine, the traditional way, the cloth from the traditional is very expensive and it has a very good luster and design. So we can, this is the handloom weaving, and we also have the generation. The total cost required for the cultivation of sericulture in India for the 2 acres, it is about 1,50,000 for rearing of the silkworm. It is a once in a way. Once we have the silkworm rearing house of 60 to 20 feet, it is okay for the rearers, which is cost about 1,50,000. And the other expenses which we need is the cultivation of mulberry and their maintenance. It is about 40,000. And for the purchase of the material of silkworm rearing, it is about 30,000. And the cost of rearing silkworm, these three cost, that 150, 40,000 and 30,000, is only for the one time investment. This is the standard one. In the rural areas, those farmers who do not have much amount of money, they use mud for the rearing house. Again, the cost was almost reduced. And for the cost of rearing of mulberry is 1,40,000. And if we have that amount of cocoons, that is 80 kg of cocoons for the 2 acres, today's rate, we have 3,15,000 per annum. This is the lesser value I am telling. And almost 3,015,000 is the proper income we will get from the silkworm rearing per annum. This is the starting phase. Once they get acclimatized, their income will rises and rises. So this is the benefit of silkworm, and I hope that the silkworm not only create an opportunity, but it also create the job available for the youth, and we will be the leader in the silkworm industry. So thank you once again. Thank you Humne sir for giving me a chance to deliver the lecture. Thank you once again.